one of the Alaska State Museum's 2017 through 2019 solo artists. She's one of eight. We're so happy to have her exhibit here. She had a solo exhibit in our old museum in 2010, so we're welcoming her back. And this show is Moving Mountains, and we're so happy to see it up. I'll turn it over to Annette.
Okay, thank you, Claire. It's really a privilege to have this exhibit in the brand new museum. I had never seen the museum and been blown away. So thank you everybody for having me here. Moving Mountains is the first time I've ever seen this piece hung. My studio is not this large, and I had a maquette of this piece that was about 2 feet tall, and it's very different. So we spent the most time hanging this. I think we spent probably 2.5 days with three of us on it all the time. But all the clay, the idea was to have a piece that maybe got people looking at mountains differently. Instead of being this big, solid mountain, everything's moving all the time. And I wanted people to kind of get into a mountain and look at it a different way and have the kinetic aspect of movement. And So it means a lot of different things, I think, to different people who have been looking at it so far. But the clay has the history of an old friend of mine that was actually my mentor, and Alex Combs. And he gave me 14 garbage cans of ball milled clay that was all kind of an odd mix. You never knew if it, maybe a little bit of O4 might be mixed in. And anyway, each barrel has a different color and patina because it's, you know, mixed with maybe some iron bodies with some, you know, white bodies. And some of the clay, after firing to cone 10 in a reduction kiln, had some beads come out with the O4 that had melted out into glass-like beads. So I love the history of this piece for that. And the logistics of hanging it has been, it took a lot of thought. But I wanted them to be, look like they're just in midair. And I'm actually really happy with it. I think it'll never be hung the same if it's re-exhibited. It'll be different in every installation. This is one piece that I've made, the first piece that doesn't have a key, doesn't have numbers or a plan, because it'd be kind of impossible. And I like moving mountains, it's going to move on. So, yeah. And I think there's other things, techniques. One process I used was I used paper clay. 30% of the clay body, up to 30% of the clay body's mass, I could put 30% paper pulp into the clay body, and that paper pulp burns out, and it doesn't interfere with the integrity of the clay, and it's lighter. As it is, it's about 500 pounds, it's about 150 pieces. So for the mass, I think that's pretty good for weight. But so this was the proposal for the exhibit was how we use natural resources. And that's kind of a dull line, but each one of these pieces, I've never done a piece about land as much as this piece, and also cords, which is of course about the trees. And we cut down a couple of spruce trees behind my studio where I needed to because of the fire hazard, but we were also worried about spruce aphids. And before that, in Halibut Cove, we had a huge loss due to spruce bark beetle infestation. And so on the island, I've seen over the past 10 years lots of logs lying on the ground, cut up into increments. And Homer has maybe, I think, 4 wood kilns now. But it's just kind of an acknowledgement of what keeps our fires burning and how we use this after it's cut down. And love the textures and from the ground I decided to put them back up. So it's kind of putting things back together, even though you can't really do that. So all the work really is, I think, homage to resources, really. So, and it's all these are one glaze and done in a raku firing, so it's a reduction, different reduction atmospheres that gives the different patinas. And some of them have texture because I put extra heavy glaze on them. And they're all mounted on steel brackets that I made. It was a lot of work because nothing's the same. So I work by myself in the studio. I don't have an assistant or anything, so it represents a lot of time here. And That's why I use the photograph for the, I don't like images of people usually in exhibits, but I thought my hands tell a story. And I am all about tactile things. And all my work has the look of, you know, informal. It's not finished. And you can tell it's been made by hand. So I'm going to go over and talk about, go over this side of the gallery now and just talk about the tool forms. These represent how we go into the resources. And because of the moving mountain, I had to have a miner's pick. So I have the miner's pick, clam shovel, and a couple of the spades shovels. And the one with the red kind of represent copper mining. That's a chun glaze, it's porcelain. And this is an old dip net from our warehouse in Halibut Cove. We have the oldest place in Halibut Cove, and it came with warehouses full of things from the herring days. But I made this, poured a slip over that with paper clay and did layers and layers and got that net form made. So that represents, of course, fishing. And every exhibit I have, I'm kind of originally inspired in clay by pottery. It's functional, and it's every day you use a pot. And I love the intimacy of cups and bowls that you can use and having that beauty in your everyday life. So, and the scale, as obviously these are big scale. So I always like to have functional pots. And I have wood-fired pots, boat forms, that I was inspired from a wooden boat form in Canada that was at an old store. This fellow was 80 years old and he was carving boats and he had died, but they had a couple of his unfinished boats, and they had fresh apples from the area, you know, it was southern BC, and local meat and all that. But I went over and saw this long boat form, and I had the impulse, I had to put the apples in the boat form, line them up. And the woman that had the store told me somebody else tried to do that, so it was like a form that calls for you to put avocados to ripen or tomatoes to ripen. And so I did these long boats, and of course all the years I've been on boats. And they're wood-fired in kilns of friends. I do not have a wood kiln myself. These are wood-fired in Peter Olson's kiln in Washington, Index, Washington. And it's a three-day firing. And I'm just going to pick this up to show you some of the great effects of wood firing. These are huge wads because this was stacked along the side of, like this, along the side of the kiln, right where we're throwing the big four-foot pieces of wood in it over 4 days. So maybe it was this way because the ash gets hit right here. And you had all the boat forms stacked on the side, and I was willing to gamble, and they all actually made it. And these pieces are from Peter's kiln too. You can see it had, this was a 5-day firing and a lot of heavy ash. And some areas don't have a lot of ash, but I always acknowledge the kiln they're fired in because it's a collaboration. A potter builds a kiln for a certain number of days of firing, a certain patina. There's kilns I'm able to be fired. I have friends in Minnesota and Wisconsin and Washington, and now a couple kilns in right in Homer that I can fire in. And this kiln has just been built by Cynthia Morelli in Homer. And this is not her, she has two kilns, an Onagama, which a Japanese design, and this is a 2-day firing in another kiln that's smaller. And she fired these that I did these while we were camping. We were camping in Utah, and it was a red clay body. I did these on the ground. They're a little bit, you know, but anyway, I like the story of how they traveled, and they ended up in a wood kiln in Homer, and I love the variation. And this one has a Shino glaze on it. So potters, obviously my palette is pretty mute, and I love natural colors. So the wood kiln really attracts me. This is another example of the flashing that you'll get from wood firings. That was another stacked pot in that kiln. So those are the stories. And the scale, which I'll, you know, when you make pots on a wheel, which I generally throw on the wheel, I have a treadle wheel that I sit at, it's a meditation. So, and of course when I made all those rock forms, it was really a meditation. So I love working in clay, and tomorrow morning I get to work with kids in clay, so that'll be fun. Anyway, I'm going to go over this direction, and I have the smallest, most delicate piece over here. These were actually pieces of stoneware that I wrapped around eggshells that I blew out. And these were in the base of that wood kiln that we were throwing wood in for 3 days. And I pulled these out. I kind of love the heavy crust, and they really look like they've been through a 3-day firing at a couple thousand degrees. But to me, it just shows the fragility of life and I just love the effect that it just kind of hits me. I always tell people, I want my work, if it's a good pot, it hits you in the gut. And if you react to the pieces here in a way that you can't understand, I like that. I like that. So this was fired in the index kiln, Peter Olson's kiln. And then and I also like the echo of the shape, which was not intentional. There's a lot of oval forms in this exhibit, from the wadding and the firings, from the shadow on some of the rock forms, just from the high reduction firing where they were sitting on the kiln shelf. There's that shadow. And of course, the big fish skin piece, the sea within us, is that form. So kind of has that echo, which I didn't really intend to have, but I observed that as we were setting up the installing. So the final piece, which I'm surprised I did, another large fish skin piece. This is my third large installation. The first one that I exhibited was at my exhibit in 2010 here. It was called Home Economics. And it was all about the fish that we eat in totems for 6 months. And this piece is continuing on because I can't get over when I look at fish skin now after a meal. If I skin the fish, the skin is so beautiful, it's hard to throw away. My freezer's getting to, you know, have a problem there. So, but this is from gill netting for salmon and long lining for halibut, which you have bycatch of ling cod, rockfish, and then there's some black cod in here, sable fish. But these are all fish that, a couple of them we did not eat. I actually inserted a few of these really yellow skins are really old fish skins that I got from Fran Reed before she died. And Fran Reed, I think it was 2007, when she was diagnosed with lung cancer. She had a couple months left to live. She didn't know how long, but she knew not a long time. So she invited 10 artists to go across the bay to Kasitna Bay and Homer and Kachemak Bay to pass on her knowledge. And that was the middle of salmon fishing for us. But I told my husband, Marvin, that I had to go do this. It was the biggest day of the season, but I did it. And I'm really glad I did. I went and I didn't think I'd ever use this technique because I love clay. But a year later, we did an exhibit. We call ourselves the Skin Sisters, and we did an exhibit to honor Fran. And that's when I actually made the large home economics piece that traveled to the State Museum. And it just tells a story of my life. It's been, I think, 44 years. My husband Marvin's right over there in the gray vest. He's right hand helping install the exhibit all week. But 44 years I have a commercial fishing now, so it certainly, it's small boat fishery, coastal communities. It sustains us all. What would we do without our salmon? And you know, I might do another piece. I don't think I will, but if there's another story, I'll do another piece. But this one's about sea within us. And after I did this piece, a friend in California told me to look at a film from Iceland, and it was pronounced in sea, and it was translated the sea within us. So some things are kind of, you know, interesting. Anyway, thank you all for coming. If there's any questions, as I rambled on, that you have about technique or history or anything, feel free.
All right.
Yeah, thank you.
Treasures of Alaska.
Yeah, it is our treasure, isn't it? Yeah.
Right, actually, you have one. Say the net was actually, is that actually a net that was dipped?
That's a net that I was some, it was some same twine we had in the warehouse, and I just sewed it together to make the, bagged it. And then I hung it in my studio and put a big tray underneath it, and I poured paper slip over it, paper clay slip. And then I had to build it up about in spots so it didn't sag over about five layers. And then when it's fired, I did experiments, when it's fired, it's hollow inside just like coral.
That's what I was kind of like noticing.
Yeah. I mean, you can do a whole lot with paper clay. It's got me thinking about some other things.
So you could, it actually just burns out the fiber.
Just burns out. And the cellulose within the paper clay opens it up so it doesn't blow up or anything with that in there. Yeah, which
I just called you Brand, didn't I?
Oh, did you? I didn't hear
you just
that.
Said what you're talking.
Yeah, yeah. Annette. That's okay. That's okay.
I really loved her stuff too, and that knowing yeah. that those little pieces of
yeah, 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 yeah.
Really.
Oh yeah, there's a piece of Fran Reed's right out in the hallway. People could
oh,
look
yes.
at.
Oh yes. Yeah. Oh yeah. I know about that one. Good to meet you again.
Yeah. Good to meet you too.
I do have a question. A couple yes. questions actually.
Yep.
On your salmon skin. How did you get it to lay so flat, and did you tan it with yourself with like alum or?
Didn't tan it.
You didn't?
No. The Yupik didn't tan like a lot of their boots and everything.
It's all air dried.
Yeah. Okay. What I did is I just stitched it wet. Yep. And then I stretched it, made sure, because it has all different species has a different stretch. Mm-hmm. And some of it, like sablefish, it's almost like nylon. It can stretch all different ways. When you cut out a pattern and try to fit it in, it'll stretch all wacky. So I just stretched it out, tacked it on a board, and let it dry, and then it shrinks. And so you can see how
it's
it kind
nice
of.
And taunt.
Yeah, it's nice and taut. But Fran taught us how to make a lunch bag. And she took one, it's easier to do it when it's frozen, and the Yupik usually froze. The fish because it has some kind of process, does something to the skin when you freeze it. And then a special knife that just is like a little round nub with serration, so you can, or you can use a knife, but you can get right in there and just almost take the skin off clean without any fat on it. Or sometimes you get it going and just tear it off. That's what Joe Isaac does.
Yeah.
Anyway, then I scrape it. Fran used the lube, I just use the knives I'm used on the boat. Scrape it, all the fat off as much as you can. And then Audrey Armstrong, I believe, who was at Fran's workshop in Anchorage, she started soaking the skins in Dawn detergent so it wouldn't smell.
That was my question.
Yeah, so. And I did a little bit of Dawn detergent because I actually like the smell. I forgot to say that. I like the smell of fish skin because I think we try to cover everything up. And we, you know, this is life.
Well, and as a fisherman, you're used to it.
Yeah, yeah.
Live with it.
Yeah. But I think if you go to Europe, you smell a lot more smells than you do here. We cover things
up. So I
kind of like that. So even though I soaked that and did in Dawn, tried to reform a little bit, I love the muskiness when I opened it up at the museum here. It had that smell. Anyway, so and Fran, we split the salmon skin and cleaned it, and then we sewed the two parts together. And the very bottom, where the tail was, we had a little piece of leather that we, you know, used an awl and sewed that on, so it had a leather bottom. And that would be a lunch bag that you could use, and when it wore out, you just threw it to the dogs.
Oh,
yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Did you just assemble this in place here?
Yeah, yeah.
Had it been like that, I mean, somewhere else? Had it been installed?
Actually, I had it photographed, so I have it tacked out. As I sew these, I have 2x4 foot boards, and I lay them on the floor, and I'm tacking them out to dry in a pattern if I do a large piece. So, and then they stay on that board. And then I outline the piece and number them. Mm-hmm. So these are in rows with numbers. Otherwise, it'd be a nightmare to get it back together. Yeah.
But we were saying you had to have
yeah.
or a template.
Yeah. But as I was doing it, you know, I was kind of working in small space, and you know, and but you have liberty of moving things around, as all my things do with the spacing between that. The center one, I wanted to go floor to ceiling just to have the height of a totem. And then the other ones I didn't mind, but variation of spaces. But see, all that could be changed a little bit, be fine. So that's kind of the, yeah, that's kind of a trademark of my work.
What trademark of your work would you say?
Oh, nothing is exact. There's kind of a free floating in everything I do, a little bit asymmetrical and kind of a casual, I suppose.
It's like with the Navajos, always make sure that there's one mistake in there.
Right, right, right. I don't make sure, it just happens for sure.
Right, that's what I mean, they leave it.
I call it human expression, I think. I want the gesture, and that's why I like the expression of the hands on the work, too. Mm-hmm. I think it's important to have that kind of, just the way I am. Uh-huh. It looks, you know, I love handmade things. I did a whole year residency had a individual artist grant from Rasmussen. I did a whole year to travel around residencies to learn how to cast things. Uh-huh. I've used it just a little bit because I like the handmade. When you do a whole lot of patterns and repetitive, it's good to know how to do casting and molds and all that. But generally speaking, I like to have each one different, each individual.
Uh-huh. Yeah, well, that's the human interaction.
Yeah, yeah. No one the same.
It's kind of like when you hear guitar music, you're hearing that finger on the string, the artist's hand in the piece.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Very nice.
Thank you.
I really like your room.
Thank you. I titled this piece Chords, Chords.
I saw that.
And that was because music has a pattern. And I actually had a pianist come in my studio and look at this, and she almost kind of composed a piece. She just kind of hummed it out.
Yeah, there's definitely a rhythm.
Yeah, yeah.
Of course, and I thought of a hand.
Oh, yeah.
Phalanges.
Yeah, yeah. Other people thought about shields and, yeah. So.
Yeah, but there's definitely that rhythm.
Yeah, yeah. And this piece is very musical. This piece has, like, when I had them hanging in the studio, in the studio, I was doing this to make sure they're strong enough, I could run my hand down the line and it makes a zing.
Cool.
Yeah. I can't do that here, but it's tempting, but I can't do that.
Your harp.
Yeah, exactly.
Stone harp.
Yeah. But there's a musical element to all this. And I love music. I think music hits you. No, it's just, it's happened a lot.
Uh-huh.
I've had a musician, I did a rack of dried fish skins, kind of in clay, and I had a composer come to the Cove and see my studio, and he wanted to take a stick and go, I said, don't you do that, it's clay. Yeah, yeah. So, yep, it's been pretty wonderful having the exhibit in here. Exciting.
Well, it's such a beautiful space.
It is.
You know,
yeah.
And, we're all so very proud of it.
Yeah.
And then it makes it even more special, I think, when you bring to it your lifetime experience of being a fisher person. That's so important to our area and making art out of that.
Yeah.
So when people actually go through the museum, I think by the time they get to this part, they see your roots.
Yeah, for sure,
and
for
so
sure.
It makes the art in this space more relevant.
You're right.
Because they've lived through the ages with it.
Right, right, yep. The objects here are so beautiful in the museum. Like when I look at the objects here, it's just like, it's really wonderful to have them here and then have people come through here and reflect.
Yes.
But the craftsmanship of some of the older pieces is incredible.
They're not lost.
They're not lost. They were saved. Important.
Right. They're gone back and retrieved.
Yep. It's very important. If I can smell the fish skin from here, can't you?
No, I can only smell downy. No, I'm just kidding. Thank you so much.
Come say hi. My sister-in-law sent me.
Oh, Lisa. Good to see you again.
Nice to see you.
Thanks for coming.
Yeah, I sent.
Hi.
I took a.
Good to meet you, John. Thanks for coming.
So she sent me a note. She said, "I think you met Annette."
Yeah.
And I actually.
Yeah, it took us a long time to hang this.
Oh.
Yeah.
And did you have?
It must take like a day or two to hang it, right?
What's that?
How long did it take to hang it? It must have taken forever.
It took me working with three people and being really focused. We were really into it 2.5 days, a little over 2.5 days with three people.
Did you lose any on the way?
One small one, which was a good record.
That's really.
Yeah.
Have you hung this before?
No, first time.
Okay, wow.
First time I've seen this hung in total. First time I've seen this was photographed in two parts, so it's first time I saw that hung. And the first time I've seen this chords piece, because my studio only has 14-foot ceilings. So this piece was up to only 14 feet, and then I made that shorter. So this is the first time I've been able to see it all the way up.
So when you say chords, do you mean like guitar?
Well, Yeah, I'm using musical language because I don't, as a play on chords of wood, but
yeah.
Still,
oh, nice. Oh,
but
yeah.
Still, everything kind of has a musical element. There's a pattern, that, and music has mathematics to it. And there's kind of a, even though I didn't, you know, there's a balance mathematically when you look at art. So
right.
Anyway, that's it. Just thought I'd use chords.
Nice.
People
yeah.
might think I'm smart enough to just line it all. I didn't do that. Yeah.
But this one, then, did you, was that prescribed or did you just sort it as you were going?
I did it. I hung this as we went. It'll never be hung the same.
Yeah.
We did the core first. And then that core took us the longest, and then we worked out from the core. And the whole time, I'm just kind of winging it to make sure we have enough to go out to the edge and have it balanced.
It's like your black
spots. So you didn't know what you were, how you were going to arrange it when you got here, then?
That's great.
I had a general idea, but no, it'll be different every time.
Where does it go after here?
I'm going to apply, send out packets and see where I can have another museum exhibit with it, you know, maybe. The exhibit I had in 2013 at the Anchorage Museum went to Massachusetts at the Fuller Craft Museum, which was fabulous. So
it's
I'm going to see.
Fuller Craft
Museum.
Where is that?
It's in Brockton, Massachusetts, right, like near.
Yeah.